Okay, it's the sort of academic 10 minutes, so let's make a start. Okay, those of you in the back row, I hope you can hear me and my voice holds out. I see around the class a few of my own students, which I take as a great compliment. They've been listening to me for the last 4 weeks and they've come back for more. In this session, what I want to do is to lead us from looking at the outside of humanitarian assistance to see how close as designers we can come to the center to be able to understand something of the complexity of the ethics of humanitarian assistance, and then to be asking how design is going to react to the changes that humanitarian assistance is going through, which are very largely changes which have tremendous ethical ramifications. What I'm going to start off asking you is, how much can designers be on the inside of humanitarian assistance, and how much are you designing from the outside looking inwards? So where are you located? Are you outside the system, inside, or do you design from the outside? And how far do designers wind up separated from the end user? Now, I'm going to use the term end user interchangeably with the terrible word us humanitarians use, which is beneficiary. But I think as designers, designing something, then what you're looking at is who is going to be the end user. And this is the worst case scenario as I see it. The designer designs a product. The product goes to a manufacturer who produces it. A humanitarian organization buys it, funded by a donor who's willing to fund that purchase. And the humanitarian organization uses this product in a number of different projects. And if it's a big international NGO or a big UN organization, that product will go into all of the next series of major disasters, which could be across 5 continents and maybe 20 or 30 different countries, and probably within those countries, multiple cultures and multiple environments. So in the worst case scenario, we have a designer designing one product which winds up having to meet this vast variety of different but similar needs. And in simplest state, you know, if you design a better tent, it's a better tent for where? Is it a better tent for Ingushetia, which has winters of about minus 20, or is it a better tent for Somalia, which has intense heat in places? So the question is, how close can a designer be? And as you design and are contracted design, then whose interests are foremost in a designer's mind? Are they the interests of the designer, who is looking for the next client, which, after all, we all need? Or is it the interests of the manufacturer, who wants a product designed on which they can make a profit by manufacturing, and which they hope they can sell to a big humanitarian organization in bulk? And will that product, while the humanitarian organization may find it an advantageous product to hold and warehouse, will it really meet the needs of a wide variety of end users? So the first question I want to ask you to respond to: in whose best interests do designers primarily work? Would anyone like to offer me an answer to that? Come on, I like to work interactively. Yes?
Your client.
Who is your client? Because this is going to be my next big question.
Governments, donors.
Governments, manufacturers, they're often the clients. Because it all comes down to this question, doesn't it? Who are a designer's customers? Yeah? Now, if you ask me as a humanitarian organization who are my customers, then I have to have a really good think. Because, you know, many of us think we have a customer and we know who the customer is. But our customers are not, they're fragmented. And they're fragmented, let me take you a simple example, see, through an easy one. And here's someone in the front row. In Starbucks, who is the customer? Well, the customer pays for the coffee and drinks the coffee. For us humanitarians, it's more complicated than that. And when you ask us, who is our customer, then we have to think twice. And it was a question that when I worked for UNHCR, I occasionally had to ask people I worked with who were working with refugees. And the answer depended on where I asked the question. If I asked the question in a field office, the answer was, the refugees are our customers. If I asked the question in headquarters, in our finance department, the answer was, the donors are our customers. So we had to ask ourselves, as a humanitarian organization, a customer receives the service and a customer pays the bill. But for us, the end user, the beneficiary, received the service and the donor was the one who paid the bill. So with that, it depends who you ask. And now let me ask designers the same question. With that in mind, who is your customer?
The donor and the end user.
Now, how easy is it to communicate with the donor and the manufacturer and the humanitarian organization? Here in New York, probably fairly easy. How easy is it for designers to communicate and understand the needs of end users, recognizing end users are a wide variety of different locations and different people? How do you as designers get that understanding of who the end user you're designing for? Because if that information isn't coming back to you, then you've forgotten half of your customers. And you're really designing a product which, you know, is for the person who pays the bill. And the question I'm asking you is, in humanitarian, if you're designing to meet humanitarian needs, is that ethical? Is it ethical that you design for the business end of what we do, rather than the needs of the multitude of different beneficiaries, end users that we serve? And this is where I see the danger of design for this nebulous thing, humanitarianism, because it is such a fragmented group of people who we're designing for, and it's a group we do not know. Who are we going to be designing for next year? We've got a good idea where the end users are this year, but it's anybody's guess where they might be next year. Where is the next major disaster going to be? So how are we going to, ahead of time, start to be able to design for those people? These are some of the dilemmas we face. And there is a whole branch of problem theory which divides problems into two sorts. And it divides problems into what are called tame problems. And I think from what I hear, tame problems are very often the things designers design for. We can give you a set of criteria, or you can see a set of requirements, and you can design something for that set of requirements. And a tame problem is a problem like solving a mathematical equation. You know the problem precisely, and you know when you solved it. But humanitarian assistance, unfortunately, is not a tame problem. It's what problem theory calls a wicked problem. And wicked problems are defined like that. It's difficult or impossible to solve because the changing requirements that are often difficult to recognize. And as we go into a new emergency, a newly emerging humanitarian problem, that's the sort of situation we find. And the problem with this issue is that by going in and trying to solve it, you are actually changing the problem you're trying to solve. You become part of the environment, and your solution becomes part of the problem itself. So if we go into a situation, and in a simple example, we set up a camp, then we've changed the whole problem. Because now we have built a new environment. Now people who are not included in that camp where they get assistance will start being attracted to it. So we've changed the problem. And through everything we do, we have the same situation. As we work, we change the problem we're working for. So every solution element we put into one of these problems has got to be flexible and adaptable. If it's not, it will solidify the problem in a way that we can't solve exactly the problem we've talked about with camps. So the solution product has to be something that can be adapted over time. It shouldn't be something that is static. And the next question I leave you, if you look at this sort of thing, can you design for a wicked problem from the outside? Or do you have to come inside the problem and be designing for the changing needs of the problem you're trying to meet? That's a real challenge for designers. It's a different challenge from the challenge of designing a static problem to solve a tame problem. A static solution to solve a tame problem. And every time you start working with wicked problems, you will start having ethical dilemmas. Because you are changing people's lives. You're changing the way they live. You're changing the opportunities they have. And that clearly starts to have an ethical side to it. And I'm going to show you just how complicated our simple ethical base is. Because humanitarian assistance has a coherent and simple ethical base. And even that is something over which we have little control and one which is constantly instrumentalized. So the ethical basis of humanitarianism, we start off with something called humanity, and a humanitarian imperative, which says we have the right to offer assistance, and everybody should have the right to receive assistance if they need it. And along with that, obviously, we have to have the right of access. Because if we don't have the right of access, we don't have the right to offer, and they don't have the right to receive. So it's simple, coherent. That leads on to this idea of impartiality, a universally rights-based system in which people get aid proportional to their need. So far, it's very simple, straightforward. The right to access means we've got to be outside of every conflict so that people will allow us to have access to their territory. So if we're inside the conflict and partisan, they won't allow us in. We have independence so we can resist being instrumentalized. we can actually fulfill the rest of our mandate. That's why we need to be independent. And what do we find? We find we have a motive of compassion. That's why we do this. And that's why we want designers to be involved with us in this motive of compassion. But the problem is, as we do that, we find ourselves not resisting instrumentalization, but being completely instrumentalized. Because when you look at the logic of that, nobody has any incentive to try to reduce the suffering. Because we're out there, and you can pay us, donors, and we will go and try to reduce the suffering for you. And we start to realize that we're being instrumentalized. There are no humanitarian solutions to humanitarian problems. And so we use our independence, and we move on a little bit, and we decide compassion isn't enough. We've got to change the environment we work in. And the first thing we want to change is we want to reduce the needs. And so we start looking at human rights, and we start looking at peace building, and we start looking at root causes. And what happens? We immediately, people say, you're not neutral any longer. You're looking at root causes. You're looking at trying to change things. And when they say you're not neutral, you lose the access. And when you lose the access, you can't deliver the aid. Now, isn't that a wonderfully classic dilemma of working in a wicked problem? As soon as we're in there and try to change it, we become part of it. And you could think of every new humanitarian crisis, and we encourage designers to design for the new next crisis and for the way we solve future crises, as sudden dystopias. The world suddenly changes for a whole group of people, and it becomes a dystopia. And the problem with new dystopias are they're new wicked problems. And the great dystopic novels are not written about new dystopias. They're written about old, stable ones that have found a new horrific way of living. Humanitarian crises are not like that. It's a new dystopia which is volatile and changing as people struggle to normalize it, normalize their own situation as quickly as they can. And we have a lot of old solution elements that have somewhat predictable, limited effects, usually with quite well-known unintended consequences. And we're used to living with those in this business. We put out simple solutions. We build camps. We give people tents. We feed people rations, or we move on to a cash distribution system. And they're all old solution elements now. And we roll them out to every disaster, slightly tweaked and modified as we go along. And every one of them has known unintended consequences. We give people food, free food, and we start depressing food prices. We give people cash, and if we're not careful, we saturate the market and we start increasing prices for everybody. We give people free medicine, as we did in Haiti, and what do we find? We're putting the Haitian doctors out of business. So, you know, we know what the unintended consequences of what we do is. But they're the old solutions, they're the ones we've got to roll out. And that's why we look to designers. We need new solution elements, new products, and a way to change what we do. And sometimes we're too busy doing to be able to think about how to do differently. And innovation in our business is too slow. It is happening, but it's happening too slowly. And it's too slow because a slow innovation means that people who could have had a better solution yesterday didn't get one. So You know, we look to designers to come up with our new products, our new solutions, but they need to be things that we know are going to be better than the old products and the old solutions we've lived with so long. And one of the problems with a new product, a new design, is you've got to introduce it experimentally. You've got to start running pilot projects using this new design. And the problem, that has numerous problems. One of the problems is, it's a wicked problem, remember? And so what pilot in one place, in one culture, in one society, in one environment, may well not be reproducible in another. And so, again, this need for a flexible solutions that can be adapted as we find they worked in this environment, but they didn't work in the other. Because we constantly in this business are caught between two situations. One says that we should take the best practice from the last problem and apply it to the next one. And the other says, just a minute, the last problem was over there and this problem is over here, and your best practice may not work in the same way. But ethically, there is another terrible problem with innovation and new design. How ethical is it to experiment in a humanitarian situation? A situation where people's lives depend on us, where we are going into a situation where survival is threatened, and we're going to conduct an experiment. We're going to use your new design, which we all think is going to be great, but is it? And that was written just a year ago, and I think it sums up very much this issue. While many elements of humanitarian action are uncertain, there's a clear difference between using proven approaches to respond in new contexts and using wholly experimental approaches on populations at the height of their vulnerability. And we really don't easily have an ethic of the sort of blind trial of giving one population one solution and one population another solution, because too much depends on it. So the whole ethics of introducing something new, a new design into what we do, trouble us greatly. And they should trouble designers as well, because we've got to have a way of making sure we're not exploiting the very populations we're seeking to serve. And so this whole thing of experimentation and introduction of new designs, new ways of doing business, we need to be very careful about. So, can you do a design which produces flexible, adaptable solution elements? Something that we can roll out and change slightly for different places, different cultures, different environments. Probably three variables I can think of we've got to play with all the time. Obviously, one is climate, and the solution in one climate often doesn't work in another. We've got to look at the vulnerability to risk, either climatic risk, major climatic events, or geological risk, and so solutions from one environment don't work well in another. And more important than either of those is the solution has to be socially acceptable in the environment in which it's going to be used. And that just makes everything more complicated, because society is even more different than climate and geology. And having a solution that we want in some way to roll out to the next unknown disaster, when we don't know the society it's going to be in, is inevitably going to give us the problem if it is rigid and inflexible. we must be a flexible design solution. And who needs to define those solutions? They need to be really defined by people who are culturally and socially close to the group who are going to be the end users. And this is one of the real problems, perhaps, as I look around this room and ask myself how many of you are actually in the position to be culturally and socially close to the end user. And how do we marry up this need to have design and people trained in design, many of you in Western universities, in Western society, and at the same time be close to the poorest people who are going to be facing the next major disaster? And bridging that gap is extremely difficult for us to do. It's where I see the grand ethical problem we're going to have in the design for the future. So we have to recognize there are going to be limits to centralized design and mass production. Much as that seems like the obvious answer to meet mass needs, if we do it this way, we're going to be producing one-size-fits-all solutions to anything but one-size-fits-all problems. So this is where I see we really have to find a way of getting through this. And right now there is developing a new humanitarian ethic. It's on the move. It's going to change the way we humanitarians do business immeasurably. The world of a decade's time for humanitarians will not be the world of today. And I hope this change, this revolutionary change that was instituted at the summit in 2016, moves quickly. Because it's going to move the center of humanitarian operations away from the big international organizations and put it in the hands of the communities and the localities who actually are the main sufferers from particularly natural disasters and to some extent conflict as well. So it was based on what they called localization. Localization, putting more resources in the hands of organizations that are closer to the communities who are in the most disaster-prone areas. And through that, we use the word dignity already. We already want solutions that give people dignity, but a one-size-fits-all solution cannot be very dignified because you're imposing a solution. Way back in 1986, an anthropologist called Barbara Harrell Bond wrote a book called Imposing Aid. And it's a lesson that 30 years later we still struggle to take into account. And the idea of resilience. Communities that can respond to their own disasters, countries that can respond to their own disasters, societies that can respond to their own disasters are inevitably going to be more resilient with more localized aid than societies that have to depend on big international organizations coming in and solving the problems for them. And so that's driving the focus in that direction. That, I believe, is going to make design a very complex and difficult world to be in. Already the promise is 20% of the funding by 2020 going to local organizations. And once local organizations get 20% of the funding, I am sure they're not going to be saying, oh, that's so nice, 20% is enough for us. They're going to be saying, no, look, you can see what we can do with 20%. And that figure's going to rise. And that's where the resources for designers are going to be in the future. And I'm thinking about trying to predict the date when I guess that 20% is going to get over the 50% level. It's going to be interesting to watch the climb. That's the way we're moving. And from the outside, what are we going to see? What's it going to look like from the outside? My prediction is from the outside, it will appear as constant innovation and experimentation. Because every society, every disaster, is going to be developing its own ideas. They're going to look different, and they're going to look random, and they're going to look uncontrolled from the outside. And that's going to be a challenge when that's designing for those sorts of solutions is what the future's going to lead. But it doesn't look like that from the inside. It looks from the inside, from the community, it will appear the local solution elements are based on well-tried traditional structures and methods because they're being developed locally. And that ethically surely is moving in the right direction. But how do you design for a world where that is what is the desire of the people who are going to have more and more of the resources? And I can tell you the big international organizations are going to find it difficult to adapt because so much of what we now have developed is based on global standards and international standardization. And so we're going the opposite direction from that. And they're going to find it quite difficult to live with that. Certainly as these big organizations have stockpiles of materials around the world. And they will traditionally roll out those stockpiles. And are these people going to want those stockpiles when it comes to it? So how will design respond? This is the question of Sublevin. How will design respond in these areas? Will we be looking at high-tech, expensive designs? Are we going to be all drones and blockchain? Or are we going a different direction? Are we looking at perhaps lower tech, but certainly cheaper to roll out designs? Are we, back to our customers, looking to be commissioned as designers by big international organizations? Or are we looking for this maybe harder to find someone to commission these lower tech, cheaper to roll out designs? Because there's not going to be as much profit in them. Are we looking for designs that will be manufactured in industrialized countries? IKEA houses, manufactured in Sweden, put in flat pack boxes, delivered around the world. Now, having given people tents for 20 years, I'm delighted with the IKEA house. It's a lot better than a tent. But it is still something made, manufactured for profit by a company. Or are we going to be looking for something that's largely designed and manufactured in the disaster-prone areas? Now, the disasters tend to hit quite small areas of quite big countries sometimes. Typhoon Haiyan went through the Philippines, affected a whole band across the Philippines. Didn't affect Manila.
Industrialized countries and countries that are disaster-prone areas are not the same. But Japan, for example, is an example of an industrialized country that is very disaster-prone.
Yep, and which has the most incredible built-in resilience it's possible to have. And in Japan, you have a magnitude 6 or 7 earthquake. How many people die? 3, 4, 5.
Lots of tsunamis.
Yeah, and then you have the same earthquake in Water grunts. Totally different story, yeah. That's true. The question is, where should the innovations in this more diversified world be made? Because are they going to have to be imported, or are we going to maximize the value added that's going to the local population? And how would we design for that to happen? If we were looking for a building solution, then are you going to design, are you going to build the components outside and import them? Or are you going to be thinking, how can we make the manufacturing components that would mean we can send the manufacturing component and the raw materials, and they can be produced locally? Perhaps produced locally to slightly different designs that meet people's needs locally. On that side, you'll be supporting big international NGOs. I think that is a wonderful abbreviation for them. It was first used in Newsweek about a decade ago, and I always rather like it, but that's where you go. Or are you going to be supporting local initiatives and local NGOs? This will make it more difficult to localize and be resilient. But it's fairly logical if you follow that chain down, we may technically get a better solution, but it's going to make localization and resilience more difficult because people will remain dependent on that technical solution. Or if we go that route, we fosterize localization and resilience. And why am I going through this? Because actually, they're the key ethical issues for the future of humanitarian assistance. And that's where I think designers have to be focusing their effort and thinking how and where. Not only do you want to go, not only where do you have the goodwill to go, but where do you have the possibility to go? This will be an easier route. This will be a more difficult one. But ethically, this, I believe, will be the better one for the future. So how can you go that route? And that's what I almost have a talk about. The changing humanitarian, what is ethical design? And how will that be accomplished?
I mean, in a wider board picture, if a designer could have a look in a conflict area, when you have a refugees coming from A to B, and you think about the shelters and the camp or the integration, the sense of home that you want to provide to them, at the same time, in a wider picture, you're going to think about the consequences of all these humanitarian assistance or integration, according to ethic, how it's going to affect the conflict in A. Because those people who's under pressure could see the good resolution for those people who left and flee, and could empty the whole area, providing, achieving the goals of this conflict.
Which you mean is by providing good assistance outside, we could actually help ethnic cleansing take place.
Exactly.
And I agree, it's a risk. I mean, I showed you that for all our ethics, we are inevitably instrumentalized in what we do. There's no question about it. You know, humanitarian assistance is constantly instrumentalized. What we really need to do is give people a choice, whether they stay or whether they leave. But the environment often doesn't give them that choice. And you're left with this other dilemma then. Do I make life difficult and miserable for the people who've left, just so I'm not helping the ethnic cleansing on the inside? Because no one, however bad it gets where you're living, no one's going to want to come out and live like that. That's a bad ethical choice as well, isn't it? And Hugo Slim has written about ethical dilemmas. The man who's written more about humanitarian ethics than almost anyone else I know is called Hugo Slim. He's currently senior in the International Committee of the Red Cross, but he's worked in a number of universities writing on humanitarian ethics. And one of the topics he's written a lot on is the dilemmas we have in humanitarianism. And his definition of a dilemma is not a difficult problem. It's not a problem with more than one solution. A dilemma is a problem that has no good solutions. And what you've just outlined is a classical dilemma. It has no good solutions. And it's why we work in wicked problems. Any next comment from you, yes?
So this concept of the constantly changing humanitarian environment and how we can't, how we tend to apply kind of a cookie cutter model, and we always say that each new emergency is the worst and it's unlike anything before. And Fiona Terry kind of points out this argument that part of the problem is that we do keep viewing each problem as absolutely catastrophic and different, and we can't apply the same concepts, and we need more funding, and we can't approach it the same way. And it's kind of this, like, condemned to repeat. We do the same thing every time. So it's kind of, I don't know, I thought that, I think that viewing it as, it's problematic to view each single humanitarian emergency as wildly different from the ones that came before
right.
it.
And it's equally difficult to view it as exactly the same
of
as,
course,
as the last one. You know, there was a general in the days when Pakistan was a military government and the earthquake took place. There was a general who ran the humanitarian program to respond to the earthquake. And whenever an NGO would come up and say, of course, in Thailand, he'd bang the table and he'd scream, this is not Thailand. And I can understand his point of view as well. This is what I mean, we need solution elements that are flexible, so we can meet both the demand to reproduce and the demand to be the difference it needs to be. So that's the complex solution. You can't have a cookie cutter approach, and you can't treat everything as we've got to start designing from square one.
But it seems too, like, although we say that each emergency is different, we implement the same solutions in each problem. And so when it comes to the idea of design and the ethics of introducing an experimental design in a place as compared to maintaining the status quo when you know it's ineffective or not as effective as it could be. And so sometimes, as long as it's not, you know, an experimental approach that puts people in harm's way, sometimes challenging the status quo might be worth it.
Yeah. And that's defining the scope of ethical humanitarian experimentation. I mean, right now we don't. There are rules. There's a really a rule-bound ethic for medical experimentation. We haven't really been able to develop, and that was what this author, and it's in Norway. I think this is all coming out of, and coming out this last couple of years is we're developing an ethic of humanitarian experimentation. What is the ethical basis on which we do it? What level of risk can we take with a population, and what level is unethical for us to take, and who's going to set the agenda for those ethics? Yeah.
Can you expand on how we can push design to respond in the way that's like the more difficult route? Because, you know, the easier route is the one that basically says, you know, international, the bingos have to basically reduce their own goals, and that's not going to happen.
They're going to fight all the way.
Yeah.
They're going to fight all the way to maintain a horrible expression that some of them I've heard use when they talk amongst themselves, which is market share. That is a terrible way to think about. But we have to understand that, you know, changing the way we do business is going to be a bit like stopping a train going full speed, because there is tremendous resistance. I tell my students the story that we had a meeting once in Geneva in 2010, and we were talking about a whole new course we were designing, and we'd got together a lot of the people who would be employing graduates of a new course. We thought they'd just get their input on how we design the course. And we got through that meeting, and they took us out to lunch. And over lunch, the topic of the conversation changed. And the conversation was introduced when a senior member of a very big humanitarian organization said, 2009 was a very bad year for humanitarians. And one of us, I suspect it was me, and normally the one who managed the remarkable flexible feet of putting my foot in my mouth, said, why was it a bad year? And they said, because we had no new humanitarian disaster. Because that meant there was no new money available. And these big organizations have to manage their overheads. And the conversation developed to the point where some of these key people in big organizations will say, this goes on, we're going to lose, some of us are going to lose our jobs, we're going to have to lay off staff. And ironically, the person who said it was out of work 3 months later. Yes?
Can you talk a little bit more about how this could be, not imposing, but encouraging this approach from the donor side? Because I feel like a lot of humanitarian agencies, even if they want to do something a certain way, are very much bound by the way, like you were talking about at the beginning, with the ways the donor wants it to be or the topics they want it to be on. Like, how can the donors be brought into this conversation of what's ethical to fund?
Well, the donors have been brought into it through the grand bargain, which is the outcome of the humanitarian summit. And the donors made a lot of commitments in that grand bargain. Unfortunately, a lot of the donors' commitments simply repeated the commitments they made, as you heard if you're in one session this morning, to the good humanitarian donorship. Now, the good humanitarian donorship was signed off in 2003. The fact we find them repeated as commitments in 2016 suggests progress in that direction has not been very fast. The problem is that humanitarianism as it is now is a sustainable set of actions as long as everybody plays by the rules. And big international organizations are trusted by civil servants not to embarrass them, and because therefore political masters trust what's being done, that they won't be embarrassed either. And moving in the direction of this localization is in fact moving into a higher risk direction, a less controlled environment. And the problem is that's surely the problem of design of all sorts of things. You move into something new that's not at this point trusted. And we're going to have successes and failures as they move in this direction. But there's a limited amount of time we can go on funding big international organizations who spend about 40% of their income in maintaining their own organization. The days of that, I think, are gone. Humanitarianism has to change. It really does, if we're going to face the sort of tragedies that are coming up. We can't go on, as someone said, and say every disaster is the worst one we've ever had. We're not believed anymore. There's some terrible disasters going on. We have now, if you look at the figures, more displaced than we have had since the end of World War II. That's true. But each new disaster, it can't be more terrible than the one you've had before. But they're certainly, all of them are bad. Donors are going to have to start working through what this really means to them, and I don't think they've had time yet to really work it through. What big organizations are doing, and you need to be aware of this, is that they are franchising. And so they're taking their local organizations, their local office in country X, and they are franchising that and registering it as a local NGO. And then, as far as then, they have localized. And of course, they still hold a lot of the fundraising power. And that may be where the pressure comes on designers to work in that sort of system.
I have a good example of the DI. Mm-hmm. They have done the direct return major with the US company. And then, because in Pakistan, access is the major issue for implementing. So they registered themselves as a company in Pakistan, and now they can move around anywhere. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that's one direction of people. Yeah.
This was a really interesting conversation. I haven't been the designer in other countries. I've been the political and legal consultant, but mm-hmm. these issues around time to make acclimation with the pre-existing community and to your point, teaching the donor what the real issues are, because whatever they funded for is no longer a problem by the time I get there. Mm-hmm. And there's a different problem that they don't want to fund that I need to work on because I'm working with people, have been the bones of contention that actually required me to no longer be a consultant in that way. But on a lighter note, what I wanted to offer for your bingo was that you might also want to use lingo, right? Because lingo would give you the local initiatives that are NGOs. You could have bingos in.
Oh, bingos and lingo. I like that.
And then lingo is local right. Talk. And that was all I wanted to
offer. That is really nice. You heard it first here. Okay.
10%. Your presentation.
And it's certainly better than the term briefcase NGO, which was used for sort of new startups. In the same article. Well, there's no other questions. Wait, look at that for time. You're either all clock watchers or we had a very good discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.